Good morning, and welcome to today's briefing on quantum computing and the effort here at NASA Ames Research Center. Today, NASA leadership and the partners involved in the effort will share thoughts on the potential for quantum computing and discuss real-world applications that are being studied, as well as where quantum computing may take us here in the future. Following the briefing, media will be given a tour of the NASA Advanced Supercomputing Facility, or the NAS, that houses the D-Wave quantum computer. Will, with that, we'll start with a few opening remarks from our center director, Dr. Eugene Tu.
Hello, and welcome. It's my pleasure and honor to welcome you to NASA's Ames Research Center here in Silicon Valley for this first ever opportunity for media to learn about our quantum computing partnership and to tour the Quantum Artificial Intelligence Laboratory. I'd like to personally welcome our partners at Google and the University Space Research Association, USRA. I'd also like to acknowledge our friends from D-Wave who are here in the audience as well. Thank you for choosing Ames to conduct this collaborative research on the benefits of quantum computing for a range of challenging applications. And I'll mention a little bit about NASA's interest in this area. NASA is on a multi-decade journey to Mars with humans. We continue to explore the solar system and beyond with robotic spacecraft, and we study the deep reaches of the cosmos with our ground and space-borne observatories. Closer to home, we're studying our planet to understand how it's changing, and we're advancing the state of the art in aeronautics and air traffic management. All of these areas require breakthroughs in science, engineering, and technology that can be enabled and needs to be enabled by the latest tools and technologies. Quantum computing is one of these revolutionary tools that we will need in order to make the breakthroughs in these domains. Here at Ames, we contribute with our research in key areas of air traffic management, planetary entry systems and technologies, autonomy and robotics, small, low-cost spacecraft missions, aerosciences, life, space, and earth sciences, and, most relevant to this event, advanced information technology and high-end computing. Ames is also a key partnership center for NASA, taking advantage of its location here in Silicon Valley with world-class industry, academia, and government partnerships locally, nationally, and internationally. You're here in the NASA Advanced Supercomputing Facility, or NAS facility, here at Ames, which is the primary supercomputing center for the agency. This facility provides an integrated, high-end computing environment and is home to Pleiades, a petaflop-scale supercomputer used by scientists throughout the U.S. to support NASA's missions. Pleiades consistently ranks among the world's most powerful systems and is a great complement and leverage to our efforts here in quantum computing. So again, I'd like to thank you for coming to NASA Ames. At this time, I'd like to introduce to you the Vice President of Engineering at Google, Dr. John Gianandrea. Dr. Gianandrea leads the research and machine intelligence teams. He joined Google in 2010 with the acquisition of MetaWeb Technologies, a company he co-founded in 2005, and which now powers the Google Knowledge Graph. Previously, John was a co-founder and CTO of Telme Networks, which was acquired by Microsoft Corporation. Dr. Gianandrea.
Thanks, good morning. So I just want to take a few minutes and explain what Google's interest in quantum computation is, and this collaboration that we're doing with NASA and USRA. So Google has a wide range of products and services, and increasingly we're seeing that these products and these services are benefiting from learning technologies, specifically machine learning. And in fact, I would go so far to say that the field of computer science is experiencing a little bit of a renaissance right now, and machine learning is becoming very, very important to many, many companies in this field. And we find machine learning to be really useful for practical everyday products that you might use. So for example, Google Photos, you can search it. You can search for, say, pictures of the beach, and it will find your personal photos of the beach just by understanding the pixels, and that's powered by machine learning. Or if you're using the Google app and you're talking to Google, speech recognition is also powered by machine learning, and that's getting dramatically better in the last few years. You can talk to Google in a noisy environment, even if you have an accent, and by and large, it's working better now than it ever has. So we're seeing across our entire product portfolio significant improvements in our products by using machine learning. Now, machine learning depends on solving very complicated optimization problems, and these problems are very computationally expensive, and so this is a bit of a problem. We can do really great things in our products, but the computational cost of these features is very, very high. And in fact, we've already encountered practical problems that we would like to solve in our products, which are computationally infeasible for us to do with conventional computers. And that's even at Google, right? And we have a lot of computers. So for a few years now, we've been investing in research project to understand the feasibility of quantum computation. And we want to understand the capabilities of these systems and the future that may lie ahead of us in non-conventional computing. And we have an excellent quantum research team led by Dr. Hartman Nevin, who you're going to hear from later this morning. And a significant part of this research has been investigating the properties of quantum, so-called quantum annealers, of which the D-Wave system here is an example. And we want to investigate their ability to demonstrate actual speedups over conventional systems. So in that context, we've been delighted to collaborate with NASA and D-Wave and USRA to investigate the current generation of these quantum annealing machines. It may be several years before this kind of work makes a difference to Google products, but we think that this kind of investment in fundamental research and computing is very, very important. And so we're delighted to be here and delighted to participate in this collaboration with NASA. I want to thank NASA and USRA for their partnership here. Google does many, many different things with NASA. This is one example that I want to highlight as being a great collaboration. And we're excited to explain more to you about what we're doing and to show you the facilities today. Thanks.
Thank you. To follow on that, let me introduce the President and Chief Executive Officer of USRA, Dr. Jeffrey Isaacson. Dr. Isaacson joined USRA as President and CEO in October 2014. His career spans both industry and the nonprofit sector and includes a depth of experience in engaging academia and the broader scientific and technical communities in support of national laboratories, national objectives. Prior to joining USRA, Dr. Isaacson was Vice President of Defense Systems and Assessments at Sandia National Labs, where he was responsible for development and integration of advanced science and technology into state-of-the-art systems for National Nuclear Security Administration, the Department of Defense, and other national security agencies. Dr. Isaacson.
Thanks, Eugene. Good morning, everybody. We at USRA are really proud and excited to be part of this partnership. And in order to kind of understand why and how we view our role in quantum computing, I thought I'd take a minute or two to explain a little bit about USRA. I'm sure that everyone in the room is very familiar with NASA and Google. So let me start by going back to our founding in 1969. We're a nonprofit research organization. And it was through the efforts of NASA and the National Academy of Sciences that we came into being. Those organizations recognized the need for someone to foster partnerships among governments, universities, and private industry to meet the technical challenge then of the space age. And the first thing that we were asked to do, it turned out, was to manage the Lunar Science Institute in Houston, Texas, which was responsible for the science program associated with lunar samples from the Apollo mission. Our forays into computer science started shortly thereafter. We were asked to manage something known as the Institute for Computer Applications in Science and Engineering. We refer to that as ICASE. And this was housed at NASA's Langley Research Center in Virginia. At the time, the impetus was NASA's interest in supercomputers using parallel processing. Through that collaboration, USRA and NASA built a successful research program It covered numerical analysis, large-scale software systems, computational research, especially on fluid dynamics, where there were some seminal contributions, and also pioneering work on parallel algorithms and architectures, a full decade before parallel machines were commercially available. This was viewed as a big success, and that led NASA in 1983 to ask us to establish a second computer-oriented institute here at NASA Ames. The so-called Research Institute for Advanced Computer Science, known as REACS, is still in operation today, and that is our main presence here in computer science, and you'll hear from its director, David Bell, shortly. It's been around for 32 years. Throughout that time, REACS developed innovations spanning artificial intelligence, advanced software development, and control systems for space exploration missions. It was in 2012, though, that USRA, through REACS, entered into a joint space agreement with Google and NASA to conduct collaborative research on the benefits of quantum computing for a range of applications, particularly for optimization problems. To enable this, USRA obtained a D-Wave computer from D-Wave Systems, and that is installed here at NASA Ames and is the primary reason for this morning's event. We at USRA manage the science operations of the collaboration. It includes an allocation of 20% of the computing time for international research, for the international research community, and that's managed through a competitive selection process consistent with our mission and purpose. Again, we are really pleased to be a part of this. It builds directly on our long-term commitment to advancing space-related science, technology, and education, and indeed it extends our 40-year history on computer science and its applications. In closing, we look forward to our continuing partnerships here, and we look forward to seeing the long-term benefits of this work to the nation. Thank you.
Well, thank you again, Dr. Tu, Dr. Giandria, and Dr. Isaacson. So now we're going to talk about emerging effort here for quantum computing and start with an introduction to our panel. We have, starting off on our panel, is Dr. Rupak Biswas. He's the Director of Exploration Technology here at Ames. Next beside him is Dr. Hartmut Nevin. He's the Director of Engineering at Google Inc. And last but not least, Dr. David Bell, who's the Director at the Research Institute for Advanced Computer Science at the URSA. I want to make sure that you guys understand how this will work. First, we'll hear from our panelists, and then we'll take questions from the media first during our Q&A portion. So at the conclusion of the panel discussion, I will be joining you again to instruct you on how to do that. We also have with us Davide Venturelli and Alejandro Perdomo Ortiz, who are in the audience, who will also be taking technical questions as they are deferred to from the panel. Again, we'd like to have you guys state your name and your affiliation and to whom your question is addressed. And with that, let's go to the panel. You may.
Thank you. Good morning and hello once again. So now we're going to get into a little bit more of the details of what we're trying to do here. As Dr. Eugene Tu mentioned this morning at the beginning, Ames is the agency lead in supercomputing, and our center supports all aspects of the NASA mission by conducting high-fidelity modeling, simulation, and analysis in diverse areas, such as Earth and space sciences, aeronautics, and exploration. In fact, NASA's primary supercomputer, called Pleiades, as Eugene mentioned, is actually located right above your heads here, and is ranked as one of the fastest machines in the world. Independent of the ranking, we are more interested in the fact that Pleiades actually has a huge impact on everything that NASA does. It is widely acknowledged throughout the world that computational modeling and simulation provides an invaluable third dimension in addition to theory and wind tunnel / experiments to advance science and engineering. However, NASA has a wide variety of applications that cannot be optimally solved on traditional supercomputers in a realistic time frame due to the exponential complexity. So systems that utilize quantum effects, such as superposition, tunneling, and entanglement, provide an opportunity to solve such problems that are inherently impractical on traditional systems. So what we're trying to unveil today is the result of a innovative collaboration among NASA, Google, and USRA that resulted actually from the first Quantum Future Technologies Conference that we had organized here at Ames almost 4 years ago. That early conversation resulted in a 509-qubit D-Wave system being installed here at Ames in mid-2013, and that was recently upgraded to 1,097 qubits. Note that the D-Wave system is not a universal quantum computer, but rather performs what is known as quantum annealing, an optimization process that takes advantage of superposition and tunneling. And you'll hear a little bit more about some of the early results that are coming out of that work. NASA research, particularly, is focused in quantum systems, is focused on three general areas. Our primary emphasis is on trying to optimally solve application problems of interest to NASA, such as air traffic management, mission planning and scheduling, anomaly detection and decision-making, and data fusion and knowledge discovery. These are all known NP-hard problems. In addition to solving applications of interest to NASA, we are also interested in advancing robust quantum annealing technologies, such as error suppression, static and dynamic noise in these SQIDs, the superconducting quantum interference devices, and overcoming hidden bottlenecks when solving large-scale problems. And this includes solving challenges specific to the D-Wave system, such as optimal embedding of problems to the hardware architecture, device calibration techniques, and performance estimators. Third, but not least, NASA is interested in the broader area of quantum information sciences that includes other quantum technologies that are based on maybe photonic quantum chips, trapped ions and neutral atoms, quantum dots, and of course the gate model that experts believe will lead to a universal quantum computer, as well as quantum sensors, quantum communication, quantum encryption, and so on and so forth. On behalf of NASA, we are delighted to be partnering with Google and USRA on this exciting journey. We are discovering and learning new things all the time, but are still at the very early stages of quantum computing, not unlike what digital computers were like in the early 40s. We have already published numerous technical papers, and stay tuned, there's more to come. And thank you. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Hartmut.
Thank you. Yeah, I wanted to join the previous speakers and also expressing my thanks for this very fruitful and fun collaboration. Actually, in preparation for this event, I was sort of reminded how much competence there is around the table. And I should also call out Vadim Smeljansky, who was sort of like the main partner for us to get it actually off the ground and get the concrete pieces in place. And earlier you had the security briefing, which actually reminded me, you probably were wondering, why do we need a security briefing? I will give you a little episode that happened a few months ago. Actually, what happened then was that the cooling system of the D-Wave machine, one of the pipes clogged up with hydrogen, and we had to bring in a hydrogen scrubber to take it out. But as you can imagine, there was sort of a not zero probability that because of this, the machine would blow up. So I'm just mentioning this is that hosting a quantum computer is not like hosting a general server machine and tapping into NASA's and USRA's expertise in shepherding such systems is, of course, a great complement to what we do at Google. Now I want to tell you a little bit about the science. So since the inception of the quantum AI lab about 2 years ago, we invested in understanding the physics of quantum annealing. Because you may recall that not even 2 years ago at the start, there were many open questions. As the community doubted whether the D-Wave machine is a quantum computer at all, and whether there are quantum resources such as entanglement or quantum tunneling present. And even if they would be present, or when first evidence emerged, yeah, these effects are indeed there, then the community doubted that these effects would play any functional role in solving an actual computational task. And that's, of course, still a far cry from then demonstrating that quantum annealing can beat its classical counterpart that is simulated annealing, even for a proof principle example. So we try to figure out in detail, understand in detail, what is going on and how and when can quantum resources help solving an optimization problem and how quantum enhanced optimization could really work. Just to remind you, an optimization problem you can really think of as finding the lowest point in a function. So maybe the easiest way to picture is you are in a landscape and your task is to find the lowest point. Of course, a simple strategy how to accomplish this is you start somewhere in this landscape and then you just walk the steepest hill down. But of course, before long, you will be stuck in the local minimum, if one knows this expression. And then, as a classical system, because this is an energy landscape, the only way to escape this local minimum is through an over-the-barrier escape. You have to walk back up the hill and see whether there's a better valley behind. But quantum mechanics offers a second route, and that's where the allure of quantum annealing comes from. There is a second escape route through the well-established effect of quantum tunneling, where you can actually cut through an energy barrier to get to the other side. So now we try to understand when is this resource most helpful. And we found out it's most helpful when the optimization problem we're dealing with has a very rugged energy landscape with a lot of tall and narrow barriers, because tunneling probability decreases as the barriers get wider. So if you have a rugged energy landscape, it will help you to get through those tall and narrow barriers. And then we asked the question, oh, that's a very important point. We also found that as optimization problems get harder, they actually will all have rugged energy landscapes. So this is a typical feature for hard optimization problems. So we were wondering, if we were to put in an optimization problem with a rugged energy landscape into the D-Wave machine, what would happen? So unfortunately, it's not as easy because sort of the current generation quantum annealer we have, the qubits are still sparsely connected, they're only pairwise connected, so it's not completely trivial to put in a hard optimization problem of this type. But fortunately, we were able to figure one out, and we gave this carefully crafted proof of concept problem to D-Wave, and now this is what happened. So on this figure, you see the data we obtained. On the y-axis, you have the run times for different algorithms. We compared to two classical algorithms. And on the x-axis, you have different sizes of the problem. So let's maybe first look at the comparison between D-Wave and simulated annealing, and maybe look at the solid lines, which is sort of the median runtime. And then you would see here that D-Wave, to solve this proof of concept problem with the rugged energy landscape, took a little bit more than 10 to the 4 microseconds. So this is about a hundredth of a second. But simulated annealing running on a single core takes 10 to the 13 microseconds. So this is 100 days. You know, so earlier we were chatting to translate this. Maybe if you multiply these numbers by 100, so this would be what the D-Wave machine does in a second. Simulated annealing on a single core would take 10,000 years. Then we also compared against another algorithm called quantum Monte Carlo. And the name is a little bit misleading. Quantum Monte Carlo is actually a classical algorithm designed to run on conventional processes to emulate properties of a quantum system. And it does so by making good on a basic tenet of quantum mechanics. Actually, this to me is what makes quantum mechanics so fascinating. Because the key teaching of quantum mechanics is that despite appearances, every object is really a multi-object that exists in all its possible configurations at once. So while a classical set of bits is in one specific configuration at a time, the quantum bit system would be simultaneously in all possible configurations. And quantum Monte Carlo emulates this by, let's say, modeling the D-Wave chip not as a single chip, but you virtually produce a whole bunch of copies and allow every copy to evolve slightly differently. But you can imagine managing sort of this multiverse, so to speak, comes with a significant overhead. You have to administer all those copies have to talk to each other. So it's expensive. That's why, again, we found a runtime difference of 10 to the 8, which I should have mentioned this earlier. 100 million is the runtime difference between D-Wave and simulated annealing, but also, in the worst case, between D-Wave and quantum Monte Carlo. And this big difference is because a quantum chip is a true native citizen of the multiverse and doesn't have to emulate this sequentially or parallel. So with this, I want to come to the conclusions, and I figured sort of since some of the topics here are a little bit subtle, I thought it would help us all to just write down what are the main take-home messages. So what we found is that quantum code tunneling takes place in the D-Wave machine involving at least 8 qubits, and it plays a computational role. Then such finite range tunneling is a useful computational resource for hard optimization problems with rugged energy landscapes. Then for higher order optimization, rugged energy landscapes become typical. And also important, such problems are, as was mentioned before, ubiquitous in practical applications in engineering and machine intelligence in particular. And then for a carefully crafted proof of concept problem, we're able to demonstrate a 10 to the 8, 100 million speed up relative to the algorithms of simulated annealing and quantum Monte Carlo. I should note, though, that I mentioned earlier, the current D-Wave chip has only very sparse connectivity between the qubits. So there are still special algorithms that exploit the sparsity, and they would run faster. But we are not worried about this because they will be, such specialized algorithms will become ineffective as the connections get denser. So now we feel we understand how to design next generation quantum annealers that will make it possible or make it easier to input hard problems of practical relevance. And therefore, we are optimistic that the significant runtime gains we observe will carry over to problems of commercial relevance. And with this, I want to thank the very capable quantum AI team on the Google side. And again, thanking NASA and USRA for hosting us here. To David.
Thanks, Harvey. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk about our partnership with NASA and Google for the Quantum AI Lab. This partnership builds on our 30-year history, as was mentioned, with the Research Institute for Advanced Computer Science here at NASA Ames Research Center. It's been a great collaboration with NASA over the years, with a lot of firsts produced in artificial intelligence especially, the first AI software to make a published astronomical discovery, first AI software to control a spacecraft in deep space, the first AI software plan the work of rovers, robotic rovers on other planets. And we're very excited to see what kinds of first result from this research activity with Google in the mix, where we're combining quantum computing and artificial intelligence. One of the key research problems we've been looking at over the years in artificial intelligence is planning and scheduling. It's one of the core problems in AI. And things that were basic research many years ago are in production operations for most robotic missions today. But still there remain challenges in planning and scheduling in terms of producing optimized plans and schedules. This is one of the real world applications that we think that quantum computing has a real capability to solve, and it has many real world applications for air traffic management, as well as coordinating various other objects like unmanned aerial systems here on Earth, small satellites in low Earth orbit, as well as robotic rovers on other planets. One of the initial findings of our team here, working with NASA, has been that within this class of crowd planning and scheduling problems, there are subclasses of these real-world problems where they're very hard, even when they're relatively small. They're very hard for classical computers to solve when they're relatively small, which is perfect for the kinds of quantum computer we have today, which has a limited number of qubits, quantum bits, compared to what it will have in years to come. And so this is, these small but hard problems are where we're focusing a lot of effort in both the basic research as well as in device physics, as well as applied research for these applications. As was mentioned previously, USRAE has responsibility for science operations for the lab. We also have responsibility for the technical operations to keep the computer up and running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, in collaboration with NASA's Ames Research Center, especially the NASA Advanced Supercomputing Division, who's hosting us today, as well as with D-Wave Incorporated, who just does an amazing job of helping us keep the machine up and running. For the science operations, we have a goal of enabling a diversity of research in both applied research and basic research in quantum annealing, in quantum computing, and developing the next generation of workforce that will have quantum computing expertise. And for this, we have four parts to our university and industry engagement program. First and foremost, we've made 20% of the time on the machine available for free to qualified university and industry participants through an annual competitive selection process. We held our first competition last year. We selected 8 proposals. 3 of those were in basic research around device physics. 3 of those were in applied applications for machine learning. And the other 2 were in other applications for chemistry and optimization. We have recently announced our cycle 2 request for proposals. And so I'm hoping you will help us get the word out. We have received a number of proposals already. We will announce the selections of those relatively soon. But we keep the proposal opportunity open year-round, so people can keep proposing throughout the year. We're happy to report that some of the initial projects are producing results and publishing papers, and that some of the projects involve graduate students who are now pursuing careers in quantum computing, who without the free time most likely otherwise would not have been able to pursue careers in quantum computing. So we really appreciate this partnership for our mission, which includes education and helping develop the next generation workforce. Another part of element of our program is we host workshops, seminars, we provide training on the quantum computing. We invite industry and universities to come to these workshops, share research results, talk to each other, find new ideas for collaborative research. We have a visiting scientist program where we host scientists from around the world to come, sit side by side with members of the quantum AI lab team, do collaborative research. We learn from the visiting scientists learn from us, and it helps evolve this whole ecosystem around quantum computing. And then we do, on occasion, joint proposals with other organizations for focused research projects. To date, we have over 50 registered users of the system who have solved over 21 million problems with the quantum computer, and there's more being solved every day. With our partners, we're very focused on producing this diversity of research, helping develop that next generation workforce, and we really appreciate your interest in our activity.
Wow, that's a lot. So I want to remind you all, the media that did show up, sorry Hartman, through part of your presentation, we want to give them an opportunity to really get involved with Q&A. We also want to remind you all that we have a distribution box in the back so you can plug in to get great audio from both for both of your purposes here on the podium as well as back in your studio for later. I'd like to thank everyone for coming out, and I'd like to really start the Q&A portion of our event today. So be mindful that we'd like to keep your questions focused on the topic, quantum computing, and you're welcome to ask a question from the audience. It's a nice audible room, so we won't need a mic runner, but we'd like to please remind you to state your name and to whom your question is addressed. And if those folks need to be asked technical questions here, Davida and Alejandro will come up to the podium to answer those accordingly. So with that, who would like to be the first one? Up here, please.
As Alice Hedbar from the Wall Street Journal, I wondered what are some of the practical problems that Google has found it can't solve with traditional computers that maybe quantum computing can solve? An example.
Is that directed to department? Okay.
Yeah, in the beginning, that's actually how my personal entry was into this field, is to look what could you do in machine learning if you had a magic box that does optimization problems better. And we published a couple of machine learning results that specifically rely on hard optimization. I'll just give yourself this, what I think is the sexiest example. We always say it's sort of the age of big data, so we have big data to give our machine learners. Now, the secret is that it takes a long time to get a big, clean data set. So big data often means dirty data. And what we developed is an algorithm that was capable of, or I should say the other way around, a machine learner normally isn't very good in digesting polluted data. So you have to painstakingly clean your data. But we developed a quantum machine learning algorithm that could digest very polluted data. And you could actually prove that it could reproduce what's called the base optimal classifier, so the best classifier possible, with up to 50% pollution in a binary decision problem. So I always liken this to sort of to me that's a hallmark of intelligence, because I liken it to sort of the smart kid in school that's able to say, hey teacher, wait a minute, what you just told me is not correct. And with a quantum machine learning algorithm, you can do such a thing. So sometimes I quip that we use the saying computer science, that in or garbage in, garbage out. So with such an algorithm, you could do garbage in, gold out, because it can filter out the errors.
Okay. Peter Folks with Inside HPC, question for Rupak. You've recently upgraded the D-Wave machine, as you've sort of explained, possibly in the last 6 months or so. Can you characterize what things you can do with the new machine that maybe is different to what you were able to do in the first couple of years?
Well, yes. But one of the things that we have talked about today is that the D-Wave system is not large enough, because I think a lot of us would really like to see a apples-to-apples comparison. I think all of us like that, and we do that on a daily basis. So we would like to take a problem and run it on a supercomputer or a single core and run it on the D-Wave system and show that the D-Wave system is better than that. And that's what Hartmut and his group has been doing, is looking at these special problems that are emblematic of other problems that have these really certain characteristics. But independent of that, the point, though, is that the D-Wave system is still relatively small. Now, we focus a lot on the qubits, the number of qubits, but it's not just the qubits. There are other things that are part of that as well. So one of the things that has happened with a larger system is that we are able to solve larger cases of problems. But the more important thing also is that the noise in the system is actually lower than the original 509-qubit system. And that's an important characteristic of the system. We tend to focus on the number of qubits, but there are two other aspects that I always try to focus on. One is the noise in the qubits and the couplers, which is lower in the newer system. And the other thing is the connectivity of the system. The connectivity of the system is still the same. It's still a chimera graph. You know, it's made up of these unit cells that are bipartite in nature. But the fact that it has at least double the number of qubits and has a lower noise allows us to do larger problem sets, and therefore have more confidence in that the extrapolation of those results to larger systems will actually show linear speed ups as opposed to exponential increases in time.
Right here in front with the blue shirt, sweater.
Tom Simon with MIT. Were those results you shared, Hamer, have those been peer-reviewed and circulated among other people who work on quantum computing?
Yeah, so thanks for asking this. Actually, just in preparation for this event, we put yesterday night a publication on the archive, which has sort of all the details of the experiments. We're actually also planning to publish the benchmark tests so other people can try themselves. But yes, we have reviewed these results with Matthias Troyer, whom I always like to jokingly refer to as the captain of the red team, and I take this as an honorary title. So there are other groups at other universities with whom we closely work and who often sort of challenge various results. And of course, yeah, so answer is we have started this process, and there are a number of these things under embargo, but there's a number of publications on the way.
Yes, please. Deborah Todd, Reuters, for David. You mentioned that over 50 registered users have solved over 21 million problems. Can you discuss some of the problems and some of the practical solutions they could provide?
Sure. So a lot of the use is Google and NASA. The use case I was talking about was all the partners. On the NASA side, planning and scheduling is one of the application areas that we've focused a lot on. I talked about that. Fault management is another area that Alejandro has worked on. In large-scale engineering systems, especially with NASA, we can't afford where you send one rocket up into space and you have one spacecraft. You really have to have highly reliable systems, and highly reliable complex systems. And you can't afford one failure because you could lose a mission. And so managing faults is one of the key research areas that's taken place in the Intelligent Systems Division for a number of years, and now is one of the areas that we're looking at for application of quantum computing. There's been other things looked at in terms of pattern recognition for earth science data. And in the university community, machine learning in general is one of the research areas that's been focused on. There's been one proposal looking at a chemistry application, and one just in terms of general optimization, in terms of the applied parts of it. And then another set of the use of the machine, a large part of the use is on the fundamental research side, studying quantum annealing. So the quantum physicists, most of the research team is quantum physicists. It's not an easy thing to take a problem and map it into the structure that can be solved by the machine, these quadratic, unconstrained binary optimization problems, and then embed it into the physical architecture of the chip, which has this limited connectivity. And so as the team develops theories of how quantum annealers should behave, we can then take those theories, run experiments on the machine, and compare it with the theory, and see how close the theory and is to this physical implementation. So a lot of it is there's a range of these research projects like that.
My name is Nakada from Nikkei Business Publications, Japan. I'd like to ask Mr. Naven. So recently, many researchers building optimization applications on simulated quantum annealing. So is it easy to port these applications to D-Wave systems? Because you mentioned that recently, D-Wave has a limitation of connectivity. So it needs to optimize some optimization to make optimization application on D-Wave to run efficiently. Is it easy or difficult?
Unfortunately, this was a point I tried to get across. At this point, it's still very hard. So what we established that in principle, many optimization problems should benefit by a huge runtime gain. But today it's still very difficult to input those problems for reasons that, say, David mentioned, that the connectivity in the graph is sparse, that only pairwise connections between qubits exist. We would like to have groups of qubits talking to each other. So there's a number of improvements that need to happen for next generation annealers to make it easy for an user to input the optimization problems they are interested in. So we are not there yet.
So does D-Wave compiler help you to make applications easier?
Yeah, D-Wave is, of course, very well aware of these issues, and the next generation D-Wave designs will address this in part, I'm sure.
Thank you. One more question. So, would you tell me something about your recent activities with Professor Martinez in
UCSB?
UCSB.
Actually, John Martinez is sitting there in the back of the audience, and he heads the quantum hardware efforts at Google, because based on the learnings of the D-Wave machine, of course, have all sorts of ideas how you should evolve quantum hardware, and John is one of the world experts in this field, and we were eager to build sort of next generation chips in annealing, but also in the circuit model that will advance our agenda of having better solutions for machine intelligence.
Thank you so much.
But I encourage you to talk to him directly, Wendy.
Right over here.
Mike Lindeen with Fox Business, Fox News. For those that aren't scientists in this room and just around the country, how is the work that's being done here going to help everybody, everyday Americans, people around the world? You were mentioning before how it's improving air traffic control, and also with Google technology. Can you give examples of how this is helping everyday people?
Yes, actually, a few weeks ago, I was in the Amazon forest, and this trip drove home to me that if we don't do something about the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere, many of the things we are doing won't matter very much for our children. And fortunately, I think we are lucky there. Some of the first applications that come to mind for quantum computers are really these humankind helping applications. For example, in quantum chemistry, quantum simulation is one of the first natural applications for quantum computer. This was actually what Feynman realized, that because of the multi-object nature of quantum objects, classical computers can just not address certain issues. So if you want to design better batteries or better solar cells, make a better desalination plant, or coming back to my first example, it's conceivable that we could build much better catalysts that could pull CO2 directly out of the air. So there will be a number of very basic applications that address the very problems that we have. I hope the quantum processors we build will turn out to be a very valuable tool for people who work these fields.
I'd just like to follow up on that. You know, as I said, you know, quantum computing or quantum information sciences is still in its early stages. So it'll be very hard to say right now that these are the impacts that you're seeing right away. But just like Hartmut was saying, all these efforts that are going on in optimizing certain things that affect our daily lives is going to have, if this turns out, to have a huge impact. You know, things, every little optimization helps, and if you scale it up, that could have a huge return on investment. And so we are hopeful, and again, it requires a lot of work, but as I said, you know, just like digital computers were, you know, 50 years ago, no one could have foreseen where they have ended up now. And we hope that this will also be that, but this is really a revolutionary and a disruptive technology that could have a huge impact on everything.
And just to add, it's the potential for impact.
Yeah.
On the planning and scheduling side of things, just as one concrete example, NASA Ames has a tremendous confidence in supporting and doing research on air traffic management. It's one of the core research areas of Ames. With doing research both to improve efficiency in traffic management when planes are in the air, but also surface management when planes are on the ground at the airports. And you know, any improvements in those, even minor percentages and things, can really change the lives of the everyday citizen who goes to the airport, takes a flight, runs into a delay, or other issue. And so that's one of the potential areas where quantum optimization could potentially have an impact for everyday citizens.
We have a question in the back by the camera.
Sorry, I have a really basic, stupid question, but you're talking about applications that are in use today. So are those applications in real day commercial use, or is this all still kind of hypothetical or in the testing phase? And Dr. Biswas, you were saying if this happens, I don't know if you made a mistake in saying if, but the quantum computer, is this a real thing that's moving forward? And what kind of time frame are we looking at that this really enters into our life? I was expecting today to come and hear something that was a lot more tangible, but it's still, for me, a little bit pie in the sky. Perhaps my ignorance. So maybe just if you were explaining it to no five-year-old.
Well, no, this is well. This is still in its very early stages. Let's just be very clear about it. And from a NASA perspective, you know, we are doing a lot of research. So this is still a research activity. This is not a commercial product. This is not like you can go to your, you know, shopping mall and pick up one of these quantum computers so you can start texting and do FaceTime. It's not there. So it is not stupid. It's not nothing like that. But it's a lot of research. And again, the research aspects of this are manifold. You know, it's not just about the hardware being more robust. You know, once we get take a look at the D-Wave system, you're not going to be able to just put it in your kitchen anytime soon. So there are aspects of that. Then there are facility operations. How do you actually run such a system? And things will get better over time. There'll be other things that'll come around. And then, of course, there's the whole algorithm development of this. How do you use it? Many of us use smartphones, but very few of us actually understand how they all work. And we don't need to. We press a button and we press A and we expect A to show up on the screen. And then that A gets transmitted over thousands of miles to some other point on the Earth. Obviously, something is going on to make this all happen. Quantum computer is not at that stage. We are still in that place where we are pressing an A, hoping that the A shows up, and hoping that B does not end up the other side of the world. So we are at that point. So all that work has to happen, from hardware to facilities and operations, system software, compilers, debuggers, you know, as well as applications, to get to a point where it becomes, you know, like a product or a commodity. Now, the debatable part of this is, well, we don't know if this is where it's going to lead to. We don't know if D-Wave is the right system or some other system will come around. It'll be very hard to predict when exactly this is going to happen. I think everyone wants to know. We live in an age where we want to know answers right away. So I think everybody would want to know a prediction when this is going to happen. That's a hard answer to say, but we could all guess. And, you know, we could say 5 years, 10 years.
But is it still possible that the binary computer as we know it, those supercomputers, can be efficient enough to do what you're hoping the quantum computer will do?
No. So the point here is that binary computations, because of the nature of how we do digital computers, the fact that there are bits, which are either 0 or 1, basically forces you to be in one state or another. And the way we do parallel computing, for instance, is basically we have millions of these bits that allows you to do certain things. Things like quantum Monte Carlo is basically simulating, in some sense, a quantum device that allows you to be in multiple states at the same time. Quantum mechanics, quantum physics, by its very nature, tells you, and no one disputes that quantum physics allows you to be in multiple states at the same time. So the theory is there. There is no doubt about that. And in fact, you know, there have been numerous lab experiments that shows that quantum mechanics or quantum physics is real. The challenge always has been, can you actually leverage that and build a system that actually takes advantage of that? And so if you can get to a point, and again, I'll use the word if you can get to a point where you can actually build a system that takes advantage of it, there is no way a binary computer can ever get there, independent of the number of bits or how big of a system you could build. But then the question still is if. Can you actually build a system that actually uses these various quantum effects and have a robust system that can actually solve problems that we need to solve? So yeah, so that there's still that uncertainty in there. And maybe uncertainty is part of quantum mechanics.
Over to the left, by the wall.
Possibly from Yonhap View Station in South Korea. I understand that this is a moonshot at this stage, but what would be the most significant obstacle that you name to the path to commercialization of quantum computers at this stage?
Well, we're NASA, we're not really commercializing things, but let me at least give you my sense of my perspective. I think when we talk about commercial products, we want them to be robust. We want them to be user-friendly. And we basically want them to be reliable, you know. And I think that the quantum systems that are available right now, whether it be D-Wave system or other activities or research activities that are going on in various institutions around the world, they do not meet any of those at this point, let's say. So the fact that they have to be reliable, they have to be reproducible, and maybe a quantum device will never be reproducible per se. But those are, in some sense, the obstacles to this. But like I said earlier, it's not about the widget itself or the device itself being reliable and robust. It's also the various applications that can use it usefully. You know, the fact that smartphones are so popular today is not just because that they are robust and reliable, but the fact that there are all these other applications that have been developed that use the smartphones have made it much more than just a phone device. It has become more than that. And I think those are all the things that have to be done over time to get it to a point where it's commercial or commercializable. And from a NASA perspective, I think we'll be extremely delighted that if NASA did something to be able to make something that ultimately became part of the consumer product line.
Okay, right here in the third row.
Yeah, I have a question for Harmut. So earlier you showed a graph that illustrated the speed of quantum annealing approach versus the simulated annealing. Can you explain to my readers what questions one asks about using, I guess, annealing equations? I mean, is it that all questions about optimization can be solved 10 to the 8 times faster when you're using this, or what is that?
Answer this question by way of adding to the answer Rupak just gave.
I appreciate it.
So let's say, what keeps me up at night? You know, what do we still need to do in order to make what we saw practical? It is what came up a few times. We need to make it easier to take a practical optimization problem as it occurs on some engineer's desk and be able to input this into the machine easier by suitable techniques. In our paper, we discuss routes, how to achieve this. This is not there yet, but if we could have this piece, then basically the technology stack is complete and these huge gains that you saw will be delivered to applications that matter in practice. So answering that piece to the latest question. So to your question, the 10 to the 8 was measured for a specifically carefully crafted proof of concept problem that nobody has. This is not a real world problem. This was just a stand-in for a problem with a rugged energy landscape. Many people will have problems with rugged energy landscapes, so we showed that on these, in principle, quantum annealing can win. We just need to make it easier for the chip to represent those problems.
Over to the left.
Hi, Ashley Vance with Business Week. Could you explain the example you talked about with the desalinization of the batteries and how they could be improved? Could you sort of just unpack that a little bit, why it would be useful for those particular problems?
Yeah, it was essentially Richard Feynman, Nobel Prize winner, is often credited as being one of the father of quantum computing. And what he essentially realized is because any quantum system, I mean, nature is incredibly creative in the sense that it's not happy with just having an object to be just in one configuration. It explores all possible combinations this object can be in at once. This happens in chemistry, this happens in under the hood in biology, that happens in many places. And Feynman realized that this combinatorial explosion you can never emulate on a classical machine. So it's immune. So we often think, oh, we have such huge data centers, yet like a simple protein that does something in your body is completely beyond any way for us to simulate it in its entirety. And of course, if you want to, let's say, do a better solar cell, how the photons, let's say, lead to some charge separation, that's imminently a quantum process, and you have to integrate the Schrödinger equation to understand how this happens. And with a classical computer, you can do 20, 30, 40 bits, push it a bit more, but then it's finished. So you need, because the operating system of nature, as far as we understand it, is quantum physics, you need to have a processor that operates on quantum physics to describe the other parts of the universe that also operate on quantum physics. It's not possible with classical machines. So therefore, sooner or later, quantum computers will be the tool of choice to solve these problems.
Devin Feely with KPIX, a local CBS station. And I ask this question as a layperson, but part of the name of this is artificial intelligence. As a layperson, when you hear that, you think of at least some level of independent thought, not that you ask a computer to run numbers and it spits out an answer to you. And maybe you addressed this and I just didn't hear it. Is there some level of the way that it answers these questions is different? Is there greater flexibility or creativity or independence of how it approaches coming at those solutions?
Now this question is actually one that is bottomless well if you go all the way to the end, so we won't engage in questions, you know, that make for very interesting conversations, but unfortunately often not with a solid ending, like the relationship between consciousness and quantum physics. So we are not going there. To us is the connection to artificial intelligence or machine intelligence is much more hands down from an engineering perspective. JG explains this. Pretty much machine learning is optimization in disguise. Pretty much most tasks in artificial intelligence or machine learning boil down to solving a hard optimization problem. But many of these optimization problems are what mathematicians call NP-hard. So you can actually show that as those grow in size, the compute time for a conventional computer will grow exponentially. So we hope that or theory shows us that a quantum computer can get to better solutions for these problems than a conventional machine would be. And then in turn, you could improve machine learning, machine intelligence. So that's the connection.
And just to build on that, you know, in the field of artificial intelligence, over the decades that it's been going, a number of research activities have come along. Machine learning is one of the key ones. Planning and scheduling is another intelligent activity that humans do that inspired computer scientists to look at how to optimize planning schedules. Vision recognition. There's a whole range of these areas where NASA Ames, in addition to the Advanced Supercomputing Division, which is right here that's hosting us today, just across the street is an Intelligent Systems Division with a couple hundred people looking at applications of artificial intelligence for NASA applications. And so the artificial intelligence for us part of it is looking at how to apply quantum computation for machine learning, planning and scheduling, possibly vision research, and other of these disciplines that have evolved in computer science.
Over here.
I'm Alistair again from the journal. So from what you're saying today, are you now sure that this computer you have uses quantum physics and it's faster than traditional computers? Is that being put to rest?
Yeah, there's a paper actually that defines different types of quantum speed up. Just a quantum speed up with no qualifier would mean the system is faster for a given problem than any known algorithm. We don't have this today, because there are still sort of these loophole algorithms that exploit this fast connectivity graph. But then there is something that's defined as limited quantum speed up. That is to show that the chip is, or a physical process, is faster than its classical counterpart. In this case, it would be simulated annealing. So this we have proven. So there is a limited quantum speed up available. And again, I feel I say it for the third time, if we would make it easier to embed problems, essentially deny sort of this loophole, that in a way, the D-Wave connectivity graph has a bug. It's just there is an algorithm that can just solve pretty much any problem that lives on this graph in no time. It's called the HFS algorithm. It's well understood. D-Wave knows that well. And the next generation connectivity graph will just be such that these algorithms won't work anymore. Then you will approach, hopefully, the era of unqualified quantum speed.
Probably in the back.
Jordan Novak from VentureBeat. I was wondering if you at Google explored simplifying the equipment that the chip requires to stay cold so you can reduce the size and potentially scale it out to a degree where you might be able to do more interesting things than what you can now.
Yeah, that's an imminent hardware question, and two seats over. John Martinez is one of the world experts in this area. I don't know, John, do you want to take that question?
I just would say building a quantum computer is really, really hard. So first of all, we're just trying to get it to work and not to worry about cost or size or whatever. But the other thing about that is, we're of course very well aware of this at Google. We're back into the era of the data center. So the idea that you have to have a quantum computer in your pocket, like a cell phone, doesn't really quite make sense anymore. Some sense your cell phone is just a very intelligent smart terminal to talk to the data center where you have a tremendous amount of processing. So that's more the model we're looking at. So if you need to have a complex hardware to do this at a special location, as long as it works, then you know you'll be okay. But yeah, we're working on figuring out how to scale things up, making it cheaper. That's part of the what we do is building the hardware.
Yeah, Martin Williams from IDG. I wonder if we could just look at this on a sort of global scale. How special is the machine that they have here? Are there lots of these machines in other research establishments around the world? Is this the only one? Are Ames the leaders in this, or is there a lot of this work going on? And then, kind of coming back to the last question about Google, what does Google get from working with Ames on this? I mean, why not just buy one of these machines and do it yourself?
Well, let me answer the first part, and then Google can answer their part. So the first part, of course, is how many such machines exist. We have a sense of how many such machines exist. You could probably ask D-Wave, and they can tell you. But definitely, NASA, within at least the federal government, is taking a lead in trying to understand at least quantum annealing algorithms. There's lots of efforts across the federal government. We clearly have one of the largest such installations. We know that USC, ISI, has one of these systems. We also know that recently Los Alamos National Labs acquired one of the D-Wave systems. Now, again, there could be other D-Wave systems that are being sold or acquired, we don't know. But at least within the federal government and definitely within NASA, Ames has the leadership role because we are the lead center for supercomputing. And we believe that in some sense, quantum computing is going to be more of a special purpose solution for solving all problems. You're not going to use a quantum computer to multiply 5 and 3. It will always be solving some special class of problems. And therefore, it may end up as an attached processor or a special purpose device that is attached to a more mainstream supercomputer. So therefore, we have a really vested interest in some sense for trying to understand this for the benefit of NASA. But exactly, what D-Wave's business plans are and what they're doing, you should probably talk to them. And I'll turn it over to Hartmut to answer the Google portion of the question.
Yeah, I mean, fortunately, Google is a company of enormous resources, so there's pretty much, it's hard to think of anything that Google couldn't do on its own. But why reinvent the wheel? There's just a lot of great expertise. I mentioned just sort of refilling the liquid nitrogen and making sure the room where the machine sits is very low vibration and other operational tasks. That's just something that we don't have, let's say, in the typical Google engineer job description, but there's ample expertise here at NASA. Plus, there are certain strands of knowledge, for example, as this was led by Vadim Smelyansky, always called ourselves the Russian analytical physics tradition. There are people who sort of do physics in a certain way and do analytical description of complex systems like this that are not hard, it's so easy to come by. And here at NASA, there's Andrei Petrikov somewhere in the audience here. These are excellent researchers, and without their help, the understanding would be nowhere near. Because these are not just, in comparison also to previous work, I should have maybe said, this is not just a numerical study. There are formulas that tell you what's going on. They're a little bit hard to read for the layperson, but there is really good understanding, and that's invaluable. And without NASA, we would not have gotten there. Because let's see, do it numerically alone is enormously expensive. I'm not sure whether I mentioned this effect when we were out in the room over there or here in this meeting. To produce a figure you saw, this took millions of computers for several days. So a good portion of the Google CPU fleet was needed to produce this figure that you saw. So numerics only goes that far.
All right, all the way in the back.
Wondering about how quantum computers go about networking. Can they network with conventional computers? Would it be a simple matter to have it plugged into the internet?
Our quantum computer is plugged into the internet. It's behind various security firewalls with RSA security tokens to get in. But basically, the scientists have their laptop machines with clients for accessing the computer, and they make requests over the internet and to get their answers back. So it is an online service.
It is no different than how our users access the supercomputers.
And here in front, Devin.
IBM had an event the other day. 35 years ago, when they first started discussing quantum computing, they said that it was all theoretical. There were mostly scientists and like-minded people. They said at this new event, there were VCs, engineers, people in industry actually wanting to get involved and to help make this happen. Can you guys say at what point people outside of sort of the university and the scientific community got on board with this?
I think there's already a lot of interest in quantum, quantum computing or quantum information sciences. You can almost go to almost any reputable university in the world, and they have a physics department where they have a quantum effort. In fact, like David was saying, we have gotten a lot of proposals through USRA, and so there is a lot of activity in this field. Now, this is also a very broad field. You know, there are lots of work you can do. You know, we are looking at quantum annealing devices, but there are also gate models. There are other ways of building quantum computers. There have been questions about the reliability and robustness of this system. There's also the entire, the software ecosystem that will go around it. You know, building a hardware is only one step of the game. So there's lots of effort on those fronts. And then there's also efforts on algorithms. What are the algorithms that would be specifically running on quantum systems that are not amenable to classical systems? And then finally, some of this work will also lead to improvements in classical algorithms. People will have a better way of thinking and solving certain problems. So there is a lot of effort. And I believe, again, I don't have the numbers. You guys probably know more about this from the media perspective. But there is. I think a broad effort or research effort, not only in academia, but also in companies. It's not just IBM, but it is Intel and Microsoft and, of course, Google. There's a whole bunch of companies that are looking at this thing, because as you can imagine, if quantum computing were to work, it is a truly disruptive technology, and it could change how we do everything almost. And so no company would like to be left behind in some sense. And at the same time, it is a really exciting research field. So any researcher that is interested in this field would like to get into this. So there is widespread interest in this field.
All right, over
you. You brought up previously about security and specifically how you use RSA to protection. Recently, there have been government hacks that have occurred within government computers. Is there an unprecedented level of security for these supercomputers? And are you able to talk about anything along about the security?
This is going a little bit beyond the scope of the event here today. But the bottom line is that, yes, we are very much aware of systems being hacked. NASA, of course, is a major target. The fact that we have one of the largest supercomputers in the world is a major target as well. So we're not going to get into the details here, but of course there are very strict processes and how and who can get onto these systems. And those same security levels that we have in order to get to a system, not only of accessing the system, but also making sure that a user A cannot access user B's data, for instance. So there are two kinds of things. One is whether someone has access to the system, and even if they have, they're only allowed access to their portion of the system. That same, those same restrictions and those same processes are also followed for access to the D-Wave system.
And if I may, I will pause that for a later discussion at another time. Thank you. Thank you, Rupa. Any other questions? Okay.
So I'd like to ask you about hard optimization problem and easy optimization problem, because it is very difficult for decent D-Wave computer to solve hard problem. Would you define hard and easy?
I think there may be a slight misunderstanding. So what is difficult for the D-Wave machine is representing certain problems. Right now, it would be nice maybe to have a picture of the chimera graph up. It essentially defines how each variable connects to all the others. You find that one variable is connected to just six others. And therefore, what the native format of D-Wave is a quadratic, unconstrained, binary optimization problem where the connectivity lives on a graph. It's called the chimera graph. That is sort of the native machine language of D-Wave. So this is formally what mathematicians call an NP-hard class. That means in the worst case, there's no known polynomial time algorithms that could solve these problems. Now, it turns out that because of the sparse connectivity, if you just take any random problem and input it to D-Wave, you find, oops, it gets solved, but you could have used simulated annealing, for example, to solve it as fast. So there are only certain problems, again, those with the rugged energy landscapes, where the hardware outperforms simulated annealing. But again, for future connectivity graphs, you know, where one qubit doesn't talk just to six others, but maybe to 20 others or to 100 others, also change the topology of the graph, make some other changes, then it will be easier to put those hard problems in and should get those gains.
We have time for one more question. Right. That will conclude the Q&A portion. We will be continuing our day and our scheduled tour of the QuAIL lab, but I want to remind you, those media who wish to participate, since this is only open to the media, we will be dividing you up into small groups so that you may participate in the tour, which is around the corner. Also, you will be meeting up with our public affairs team who will escort you there as well. And we'd just like to remind you, for more information about NASA's effort in quantum computing, you're welcome to visit www.nasa.gov/quantum. Thank you very much, everyone.
The D-Wave system has very strict facility requirements. And this building that you're standing here right now, this is where the supercomputer is. And because we are in earthquake country, this building actually is built in a special way on pads and rollers, so it can withstand almost up to, I think, like 8.5 or so on the Richter scale. But that is exactly what the D-Wave system does not like, because it needs to run at these really cold temperatures of you know, about 15 to 20 millikelvin. And any vibration actually causes heat that actually would put the qubits out of their quantum state. So this room has been retrofitted because there are three requirements. One, of course, is that it has to be completely vibration-free. So we had to build a special foundation over here that kind of decouples this D-Wave system away from the rest of the building. So in some sense, it's almost, it could be a bad thing also, in the sense that if there were an earthquake, the rest of the building would be fine, but the D-Wave system is not protected in some sense, because it is not allowed to have any vibration. The other thing, of course, is that it has to be also shielded from the Earth's magnetic field. So that is why you have this big black box, which is like a Faraday cage, which makes sure that there is no the Earth's magnetic field inside of it. And then, of course, the cooling. This little chirping sound that you hear is the pumps that are running to make sure that the D-Wave chip remains at 20 or 15 millikelvins or lower.
So it's like a super-duper force field from a super-duper computer.
That's correct.
Now, can cosmic rays or neutrinos affect
Could, in theory, but you know, the way the D-Wave system operates as well, this is a quantum system, so so the answers that you get are all probabilistic in nature, so you would rerun the same problem several, you know, hundreds of thousands of times before you actually get
for my listeners.
Yeah.
Exactly what this computer does, and can you talk a little bit about the quantum computing and what's the real life applications here?
Well, the you know, at the end of the day, basically, you know, from a layman's perspective, if you're looking at a classical computer has what is known as bits, which are zeros and ones, which in some sense is just a switch, so it's either on or off. So the quantum computer uses this concept of a qubit, where basically, which is a quantum bit, which, as you heard earlier today, can be 0 and 1 at the same time. So therefore, what that allows you to do is to be able to solve these optimization problems, these really complex optimization problems that you would otherwise be unable to solve on a classical system. So the D-Wave system is this quantum annealing device, which is a special purpose system that solves these hard optimization problems. So the way it works at a very high level is that basically it solves these graph problems. And you have probably heard this morning this term called quadratic unconstrained binary optimization. So any problem that you're trying to solve has to be first converted into this cubo form, which is basically a graph representation of your problem. And then what you have to do is you have to take this cubo representation of your problem, and then, so that's the mapping part, and then you have to embed it into the hardware of the D-Wave system. The D-Wave system, as you heard this morning, is a chimera graph. So basically the whole system is laid out in terms of these unit cells. Each unit cell has 8 qubits. So the 8 qubits are in a bipartite form. So in some sense, there are 4 qubits on the left. In a logical way, if you think about it, there are 4 qubits on the left, 4 qubits on the right. The 4 qubits on the left, each of them talk to or connected to each of the 4 qubits on the right. Similarly, each of the qubits on the right are connected to the 4 qubits on the left. So that's one unit cell. And then the whole system is replicated by these unit cells. So if you have a 512 qubit system, then you would have 64 of these unit cells laid out. And then once those unit cells are laid out, each qubit in a unit cell is connected to 2 other qubits in the chimera graph. So that means every qubit in the system is connected to 6 other qubits, 4 to qubits in the unit cell itself. So then you have what is known as this embedding problem, where you have to take the cubo representation of your graph and then embed it into the system. And once you do that, then you have to solve this problem. But the way the quantum system works is that every answer is a probabilistic answer. So every time you run the system, you're going to get a slightly different answer. So what you have to do, therefore, and so each of these annealing runs, each run is an annealing run, you have to run the same problem over and over again, numerous times, until you reach a point where you feel that you're confident that you have an answer that you can trust. And the way it's done, basically, either you're looking for the minimum answer or you're looking at a probability distribution of the answer. So if you think that the probability distribution is peaky enough that one answer appears more often than others, then you can accept that as your answer. Or if you're looking for the lowest possible answer and you have run it 100,000 times and this is the lowest answer you have gotten, you can accept that to be the right answer. The example I always give people is that if I give you a US quarter and you toss it a million times and you get tails all the time, it would be reasonable to walk away thinking that the US quarter has tails on both sides. But it's a possible answer. You could flip a coin a million times and get tails every time, but that does not give you the right answer. So it's the same with quantum computing. You run it several times and at some point you accept that to be the answer.
Okay, and practical implications. I mean, what's going on in the world because of this?
What's going on in the world?
Well, what are you guys doing?
Well, so like you heard this morning, there's a whole bunch of applications. Okay, so we are running a whole bunch of applications on this system. You know, from a NASA perspective, we are running air traffic management kind of problems, planning and scheduling, fault detection, data fusion. So there's a whole bunch of applications that are at the very part of them are optimization problems, and those are the problems.
Is this the quantum computer?
Correct.
It's so small.
Yes, or maybe big, if you could say that it's a big system compared to a, you know, Intel processor or something, or your iPhone. But yes, so what you're hearing is, like I was saying earlier, one of the requirements for this system to be a quantum system, and there's a picture of the what's inside of there, that's the actual chip in there. In order for it to display quantumness or quantum effects, it has to be at a very cold temperature. So basically the heart of this hardware is what we have is a niobium metal. So it's a niobium metal at very cold temperatures allows electrons to flow in both directions. And so when you have a niobium metal that is made into a loop and is cooled below something like 20 millikelvin, then it allows electrons to flow in both directions. And therefore this little loop has both an up and a down magnetic field, which in some sense, therefore, you have created a device that can be both up and down at the same time. So this chirping noise that you're hearing is basically the pumps and everything else that is making sure that the system remains colder than 20 millikelvin. We run it typically at 15 millikelvin.
Mm-hmm. Any kind of applications when it comes to space?
Yeah, possibly. Like I said, you know, there's a whole bunch of applications that anything that is optimization in nature could be potentially solved on this system.
So how big is that the system that's inside is just that size and
so
everything else?
If you go over there, what you can see is that's the chip. In that little glass case over there is the chip. And on that wall is a little picture. And, you know, maybe Alejandro or Davide can show you around a little bit. They are also experts.
That's
so what's inside of there is that whole apparatus that
makes it. So what's inside the actual part of it is quite small. A lot of it is to keep it at that certain temperature so that it can...
Correct. The actual processor itself
is... Does it take a lot of electricity?
No. The whole thing requires about, with the whole infrastructure and everything else, is probably, you know, about 20 kilowatts or something, which is a very tiny, small number.
One thing I missed was the improvement on speed. What has changed since the D-Wave system first came into NASA? Like, what type of improvements have been made?
Well, like I was saying earlier in response to one of the questions, is that when we first started off, D-Wave had various generations of this system, from 128 qubits to, you know, 256, 512, 509, and now we have almost 1100 qubits. It's not just the number of qubits, but it's also the noise of these various qubits. There is a certain inherent variability of these qubits as to what they are, where they are. And so those are the improvements that have made the system more robust to be able to solve problems more accurately in some sense. And we have a bigger, better confidence that these systems can be scaled up to larger problems.
Right, so it was an increase in qubits and a decrease in the amount of noise surrounding
Correct.
The qubits? Okay.
Correct.
Okay.